Good morning, Olivet Church family. It is a blessing to virtually worship with you today. If you would please, follow and like our Facebook page at The Olivet Church. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at @TheOlivetChurch_. And subscribe to our YouTube channel at TheOlivetChurch-ATL. We cannot wait to see you again, but in the meantime, please stay connected.
Good morning, Olivet. And a special thank you and hallelujah to our women's ministry. Hallelujah. Come on, point to yourself and say, this is what covered looks like. Hallelujah. Somebody else, point to yourself and say, this is what covered looks like. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, put those hands together. We've come to bless the Lord this morning. Is that all right? Come on, help us bless Him. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord with me. Come on and bless the Lord with me. Oh, oh, oh. Bless the Lord with me. Help me say, bless
the Lord with me.
Oh, bless the Lord with me.
Bless the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for making ways out of no way. Hallelujah, for turning our midnights into day. Thank you, Jesus. The word of God says he won't put any more on you than you're able to bear. So we thank you, Lord, for making ways for us. Hallelujah. Touch your neighbor and tell him, we're thanking God this morning for making ways. Hallelujah. For moving the mountains. Hallelujah. Yes. You made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Made a way.
When our backs were
against the wall
and it looked as
if it was over,
you Lord
made a way.
And we're standing here
only because
you made a way. Hell, Lord.
When I backed the wall
and it looked
as if it was over,
oh Lord,
made a way.
Yes. And we're standing here
only because
you made a way. Only because you move a mountain, you cause a wall. With your power, perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. We're standing here only because
only because you made. And we're standing here only because you made. And we're standing here only because you made. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Good morning, all of it. May you please bow your heads and close your eyes for a word of prayer as we celebrate International Women's Month and Women's Emphasis Day here at the Olivet Church. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for everything in it and of it. We thank you for letting us see another Women's Day and hope that we have many more to come. I thank you for putting clothes on our backs, shoes on our feet, and food on our tables. Lord, I pray for the families during the pandemic that they will be safe. And I thank you for keeping us safe during this pandemic. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Greetings to the amazing women of the Olivet Church. It is my honor and pleasure to serve as your First Lady and to work with the women of the Olivet Church. I can't believe that it has been an entire year since we have been able to worship and fellowship together. We have been through a lot during this pandemic and last year, both individually with our families and our Olivet Church family as a whole, including the suffering of sickness and bereavement. In fact, it hurts that we lost some of our most influential and pivotal seniors and our founding members during this pandemic, and that we were unable to celebrate them and fellowship and support one another in our usual fashion. Women of Olivet, please know that I appreciate your willingness to continue to support our outreach endeavors, especially during this season. Whether it was through your toiletry, snack, or your monetary donations, we are most appreciative. As I said in the past, we are a blessed people. God continues to cover and bless us because we are such a blessing to others. Pastor's theme this year is Covered, and in conjunction with his theme, the women's ministry theme is Covered Looks Like This. Romans 5:3. We also boast of our troubles because we know that trouble produces endurance. Good News Translation. Even while celebrating virtually, we pay homage to those who paved the way and made this Women's Day celebration possible. For them, we are forever thankful. As we continue to overcome challenges and with God's covering, strength, and growth in these perilous and uncertain times, we must continue to encourage each other in love and stand on God's word. To Reverend Dr. Natasha Reed Rice, we are so excited that you are able to worship with us this year. You are an awesome woman of God and an inspiration to us all. In closing, I am humbled by the love and support of our pastor, Reverend Dr. William Holmes Robinson, and the women of the Olivet Church. With great anticipation, I look forward to when we can worship and fellowship together again. Stay tuned for more information on an upcoming outreach activity. I humbly ask for your continued prayers, and I will continue to pray for you. Lastly, please don't forget to sow your seed of $100. This will assist the Olivet Church and the Women's Ministry in continuing the much-needed work in the church and the community. Olivet, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Good morning, Pastor William Holmes Robinson, Lady Erica Robinson, Reverend Dr. Natasha Reed Rice, Olivet members, guests, and friends. Welcome to the 2021 Women's Day celebration. Kicking off our program will be the Women's Litany from Sister Tanetta Norwood and Miss Amaya Norwood, followed by the welcome from Miss Whitney Branch.
Today, we celebrate the strength, power, passion, beauty, courage, and faith of women across the world.
We praise God for the creation of woman.
We honor those who nurtured us and taught us to honor and to love God.
We praise God for the creation of woman.
We honor and thank those women who fed the hungry, clothed the unclothed, befriended the lonely, and comforted the comfortless. We bless them for unselfishly loving us.
We praise God for the creation of woman.
We honor women grieving the loss of loved ones. May you, O God, continue to comfort them with your word, spoken and blessed. May we learn to encourage them as they have encouraged us.
We praise God for the creation of woman.
We honor our sisters throughout the world who need your spiritual, economic, and physical healing.
We pray God meets their needs according to his riches and glory.
We honor all the women of Olivet who have gone on before us.
We praise God for the creation of woman.
We praise God for the virtuous women who persevered through our yesterdays, influenced our todays, and shape our tomorrows. From the rib of man, God created woman. He has found favor in her and has sent her into the lives of every man and child. Amen.
Good morning, Olivet friends and family. I'm so blessed to be worshiping with you this Sunday. I would like to give a special thanks to the women for joining us virtually for this Women's Day. On behalf of Dr. Robinson, Lady Erica, and Kaylin, we welcome you.
We'll now have our occasion from Ms. Kimbra Simon, followed by the adult women's dancers.
To Pastor Robinson, Lady Erica, our guest speaker, Reverend Dr. Natasha Reed Rice, members of the Olivet Church and Friends, good morning. My name is Kimber Simon, and as we celebrate our annual Women's Emphasis Day celebration today, I would like to share with you how it all started. Women's History Month is a time when we recognize the important contributions that women have made and continue to make to society. Its origins as a national celebration date back to 1981, when Congress passed the bill which authorized and requested that the President proclaim the week of March 7, 1982 as Women's History Week. 5 years later, in 1987, after being petitioned by the National Women's History Project, Congress passed a law that designated the month of March as Women's History Month. Since 1995, Presidents Clinton, Bush, and Obama have issued a series of annual proclamations designating the month of March as Women's History Month. Proverbs 31:31, the New International Version states, "Honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her work bring her praise at the city gate." A few years after the establishment of the National Women's History Month, the Olivet Ministry was founded. The question came to mind, why aren't we, the women of Olivet, recognizing the achievements and accomplishments of women in the Bible, in our church, and in our community? A volunteer group of women met with Pastor Howard W. Creasy Sr. to discuss the possibility of a women's emphasis ministry at Olivet. The task was challenged, but to glory be the God. Thank you to Mother Creasy for serving as an advisor and for helping to make this dream a reality. During the beginning stages, the leadership group consisted of Mother Creasy, Sister Julian Miller, Carolyn Rivers, Catherine Jones, and Gwendolyn Hudson Colquitt. The first observance was kicked off with a dynamic, awesome, and inspiring conference that involved outstanding leaders of the church community demonstrating their skills and talents. Enthusiasm and excitement rang through the church. We prayed, planned, prayed, organized, prayed, and fellowshipped all in the name of Jesus. The Women's Emphasis Ministry continued to rise above expectations with monthly Saturday Bible study, community service projects, which included back-to-school book bags, coat drives, Soul for Souls, feeding the homeless, and visiting nursing homes. In addition to serving the needs of the community, we also set aside time to fellowship with one another. Although things are different during these times, women of Olivet, we will all one day fellowship again. On this special day, let's continue to move forward in utilizing our spiritual gifts and talents. We can look upon this hill and see our new house for God and the endless possibilities in store. Our theme for this year is, Cover Looks Like This, and it is true testament to what we have been through in 2020. As we continue to emerge on the other side, beautiful inside and out, worship together, ready to serve, and continue to cover one another. Thank you.
This morning's scripture comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 2 through 3. We always thank God for all of you and continually mention you in our prayers. We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor promoted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. May God bless the readers of his word.
Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe, 'cause yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. I love this when y'all says, and bodies are still being raised. Woo! Giants are still being slain.
God, we believe, yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Say, we are here for you. Come and do what you do. We set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do. Cause we need a move.
Good morning, Olivet. I am so honored to be here to introduce our speaker for this morning. Natasha Reed Rice has recently transitioned into the role as Habitat for Humanity International's first global diversity, equity, and inclusion officer. Natasha, who served as the Associate General Counsel, Real Estate and Finance with Habitat since 2011, will now join the nonprofit's senior leadership team and will lead the development and the execution of Habitat's global strategy for diversity, equity, and inclusion. In her previous role as Associate General Counsel, Natasha initiated and managed financing programs and strategies to generate sources of capital that enable Habitat affiliates to build affordable housing with families throughout the U.S. In addition to her work at Habitat, Natasha served as the Associate Pastor at the historic Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia, for 11 years before serving as the Minister for Public Life at All Saints Episcopal Church. Prior to joining Habitat, she practiced law in the commercial real estate practices of Alston & Byrd, LLP in Atlanta, Georgia, and at Paul Weiss, Rifkin, Wharton, and Garrison in New York City. While at these firms, her practice focused on commercial real estate development transactions, acquisitions, dispositions, and leasing. Natasha is passionate about providing a voice to the voiceless and opportunities to communities that have been historically disadvantaged. She puts her passion into action by serving on the boards of the Global Harvard Alumni Association as elected director. As a member of the Harvard Alumni Association's Award Committee, the Atlanta Community Food Bank, the Georgia Budget and Policy Institute, and Invest Atlanta's Atlanta Emerging Markets Incorporated. She has also been actively involved in the efforts to pass legislation and policies to protect victims of sex trafficking in Georgia, such as the passage of the Safe Harbor Rachel's Law in 2015 and State Constitutional Amendment in 2016 that outlines the operation of the Safe Harbor for Sexually Exploited Children Fund and Commission. Additionally, she is a highly regarded keynote speaker and workshop facilitator and delivered her talk called If We Are More Alike Than Unalike, Then, for TEDx Centennial Park Women. Natasha received her JD from Harvard Law School and her BA in government with honors from Harvard Radcliffe College, where she was a Harvard Radcliffe class marshal and awarded the Captain John Fay Prize, which is Radcliffe's highest honor, and the E.P. Salston Stahl Prize. Natasha is married to Corey Rice, and they are the proud parents of Kayla, Malachi, and Caleb. Olivet, let's welcome our guest, Natasha Reed Rice.
You, Lord. Oh, thank you.
together and say, thank you. We just want to say thank you, Lord, this morning. Oh, thank you, Lord. And we'll lift your name today. Thank you, Lord. Oh, I just want to thank you, Lord. Come on, last time, let's lift it up together.
Break the bread of life together. I want to come first and foremost thanking your pastor, Pastor Robinson, and First Lady Erica Robinson, the church family, and the women of Olivet for inviting me to break bread with you this day. Now, in line with the theme for this Women's Day, covered looks like this. As we enter into a word of prayer and then into the word, I want you to just take your hands and put them over your head and say to yourself, covered looks like this. Now pray with me. Dear God, we thank you for covering us during this pandemic. We thank you, oh God, for covering us during this moment of strife and division. We thank you, oh God, and we take it not for granted that this day we inhale and exhale, that this day we can rejoice in the day that you have made. For because of you, covered looks like this. Now, God, use me this day as your vessel. Preach through me, God. Touch hearts and souls in need of a savior, in need of a deliverer, in need of a healer. We commit this unto you and know, O God, that with you all things are possible. So in this moment, have your way. It is in the name of our great Savior, of our great healer and miracle worker, Jesus the Christ, that we pray. And together we all said, amen and amen. Praise God. I'm excited to be with you. I'm excited to share under the covering of the Olivet Baptist Church. And this morning, I just want to be with you for a few brief moments and share from the theme, from thirst to testimony. From thirst to testimony. In the fourth book of John, we witness the longest recorded conversation between Jesus and another person. This recorded encounter between Jesus and the Samaritan woman is one of my favorite encounters in the Gospels. Rather than begin at the start of the encounter, I want to start at the end of the encounter. If truth be told, especially in this social media moment, we often encounter folks at the end of an encounter, at the end of overcoming a challenge, on the other side of the mountain moment that was in their way. Hence the positive and confident hashtags that we see all throughout our social media feeds. Hashtag winning, hashtag God makes a way, hashtag I got this, hashtag black girl magic, hashtag good times. But we very rarely see hashtag I am struggling, or hashtag I hope I can make it, or hashtag I'm trying, or hashtag I've fallen and I can't get up. You see, at the end of the encounter in this text of John chapter 4, the story goes like this. Then the woman, the Samaritan woman, left her water jar and went back to the city. She then exclaimed to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on their way to him. And it says in the text that many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of this woman's testimony. This tells us that not only does this woman at the end of her encounter have the confidence to go back and proclaim before the crowds that she encountered Jesus, but she's so confident that she even refers to her scandalous past. She says, "Surely he's the Messiah because he told me everything I ever did." It is that scandalous past that has rendered her illegitimate and silent at the beginning of the encounter. As a result, we see in these few verses at the end that she not only spoke, but that when she spoke, others listened to her. And as a result, they too sought out Christ. She preached a mighty soul-saving sermon. Hashtag, one of the first gospel preachers happened to be a woman. So how did she get her hashtag moment? How did she get there? What transformed her into a preaching woman? How did her backstory become her testimony? When we look more closely at the text, and I encourage you when you have a chance to read the entire chapter, we see that Jesus happens to stop at the well around noon, the hottest part of the day, to rest, and while there, to get something to drink. Jesus encounters the Samaritan woman at this well, and he opens the conversation with a command to give him something to drink. So come with me now, just for a little bit, and let's eavesdrop on their conversation. So when Jesus comes to the well, he says to the woman, "Will you give me a drink?" The Samaritan woman then says, "What? You're a Jew, and I'm a Samaritan. How can you ask me for a drink?" Jesus then says, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." She then says, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where are you getting this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well to drink from it himself?" Jesus then looks at her and says, "Everyone who drinks this water in Jacob's well will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give will become in them a spring welling up to eternal life." The woman then turns to him because she's still not quite getting it. And she says, "Sir, if you got water like that, I need you to give me some, so that I won't ever get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He then says to her, "Now that you've shown interest, let me talk about who you are so that you can see who I am." He says, "Go call your husband and come back." She then says, I don't have a husband." And he says, "I know. You actually don't have a husband. The one you're living with now, I know he's not your husband. And in fact, you've had five." She then has her eyes opened all the more and says, "I can now see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." And here she's having a worship experience. "Woman," Jesus says to her, "believe me that a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain or in Jerusalem. And yet the time is actually now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth." They go on and she says, I'm waiting, we're waiting for this great Messiah to come. And he concludes this interaction and encounter by saying, I am he. As we hear in this text, the woman points out all these disqualifiers. Remember, he asks for something to drink and she disqualifies the encounter by saying, we have ethnic differences. I'm Samaritan, you're Jew. You should never share anything, including space, with me. He then asks her for something to drink, and she realizes that he's inviting an interaction. He also then elevates the conversation from physical water to soul refreshing water. And then she points out practical issues. Isn't that often the case when we encounter Jesus? He's trying to get our attention and talk to us about what really matters, the soul of ourselves, the excavation of that soul, the let's dig a little deeper. And we're like, actually, I just needed some money because I had some bills to pay. I don't want to talk relationship right now. I want to talk transaction. Jesus is not interested in transaction. Jesus and God are interested in transformation. We think and get caught up on tithe as a transaction. And he says, actually, if you read the text, it's not about you exchanging money with me. It's about you returning unto me. For when you return unto me, God says, I will then return unto you. He wants transformation. He wants relationship with us. We keep coming to God for practical, transactional experiences. And God says, if you only knew that I am he, the one who can transform your dead places into living. He can take your dry spaces and give you a water that will never run dry. Who can shift your marriage from the verge of divorce to full of joy and passion. Who can transform the relationship between you and your estranged child. This is the God that she encounters at the well. She then points out those practical issues, and he responds and gives her an eternal word. She then takes it further with him. And he says to her, not only am I asking you for water, I know why you come in the high heat of the day. You come in the high heat of the day because your lifestyle has rendered you illegitimate. You don't come at the first break of dawn when it's still cool, when everyone else is there, because those everyone else's are probably talking about your five husbands and the man you now live with. You come at a time when no one else is here because you're ostracized and marginalized. You think that you are other. You think that you're not worthy. You think that you're not even legitimate enough to encounter and engage with all others who call themselves followers. You may think you're on the outskirts, but Jesus came this morning to remind you that with him you were brought in to the company. In this encounter, circumstance meets Christ. In this encounter, impossible meets all things are possible. In this encounter, worldly hierarchy meets heavenly power. In this encounter, thirst meets an unstoppable fount. In this encounter, physical meets spirit. In this encounter, sin meets grace and mercy. In this encounter, humanity meets the Holy Spirit. The Samaritan woman in our text today had come to the well to quench her thirst. She came to a well that she didn't build, that her grandfather's grandfather, Jacob, had built. She came to a place to quench a thirst that the well water could not quench. She's not unlike many of us who have gone to church, the church where our families grew up, the churches that Jacob built and worshiped, and still didn't encounter the eternal fount. She had never had an encounter like this before at the well. She never encountered a living water that would quench her soul's thirst. She never encountered this living water that symbolizes the very presence of Christ or the Holy Spirit. She had come to the well many times, but had never encountered or received the Holy Spirit. Isn't it something that we can come to church and serve and go to Bible study and stand in the pulpit and sing in the choir loft and leave without encountering God or the Holy Spirit? We come with a transactional. We come to check it off our list. We tune in and come because someone else said we should come. We come because grandmama always came and auntie always came and granddaddy always came. But we haven't always come to encounter the living God. This is what the woman in our text realizes today. She needs a drink, all right, but she needs more of God and God's Holy Spirit to quench the thirsting of her soul. In her conversation with Jesus, she learns and we learn what an encounter with Christ can actually do and how it can transform our thirst into our testimony. She learns that in an encounter with Christ, we can be revived. I don't know about you, but this has been a long 12 months, and I surely could use a revival right now. I don't know about you, but I'm weary on some days. I try to do my praying and my singing, but I get weary. I need a revival. God can interrupt our regularly scheduled program like he did with this Samaritan woman and revive us in ways we could not anticipate. She had come to the well. That historical period is a time where women would go first thing in the morning, like I said, and she came half midday when the temperatures were high. No other men or women would talk to her without a husband present, which she did not have. So she came as an outcast. She came to this well many times before with no encounter. She came to feel a physical need. She was so focused on that physical need that she almost missed her moment. Maybe she'd given up on an encounter that could revive her soul. She was perhaps so battered by life, all she could do was focus on survival and meeting immediate needs. Anyone ever been there? But Jesus wakes her up. Jesus revives her, tells her about a living water that even she can have, peels back her layers and says, "Even knowing your mess, I'm here to offer you another chance, a fresh start, a reviving moment that reminds us whose we are." We're still trying to figure out who we are, but in this moment, he reminds her whose she is. It revives us and moves us when we encounter Jesus in this way, from the everyday to the eternal. Oh my God, Lord, revive us. Again, we need a drink, oh God, from your eternal fount. Oh God, I don't know about you, but in this moment of strife and senseless violence and injustice and stress and pain, we need the Holy Spirit to fall fresh. We need a drink. We don't have time for vain strivings and vain worship and vain repetitions. We need power from on high to live through this pandemic after pandemic. An encounter with Christ revives us. An encounter with Christ reminds us that we're worth it. Somebody say, "I'm worth it. I'm worth it. I'm worth it." This is what covered looks like, because I'm worth it. Reminds us that we're worth it. Did you know that you're worth it? I know you've done some mess. I know, like this sister, you have a past that you don't really want to proclaim in front of folks. I know that you've done some things and said some things and denied some things and avoided some things, but this day, can I come to remind you that you're still worth it? You're worth all that God has for you. You're worth all the blessings that God has promised. No one can steal your worth. When you are a child of the living God, the one who created you in God's own image, God is saying through this text that just like this Samaritan sister, you are worth it. Jesus reveals her truth because he wants her to know even your truth can't stop my love. And I hear Paul, I hear you, Paul, for the love of God is so strong that neither depth nor height, neither angels nor demons, neither you nor your past can stop the love of God. For the love of God is so wide, we can't get around it. It's so high, we can't get over it. It's so low, we can't get under it. The love of God is hollering through this text to tell you you're worth it. You're worth it. I came and died for you. Grace of God. God is not looking for perfect worshipers. God is not looking for those who have not sinned. God is not looking for holy of holies. God is looking for perseverance and spirit and truth, for honesty. God is looking for those of us who throw open our arms and say, God, not by my might, nor by my power, not by what I think I can do to get right, but by your spirit, I'm worth it. I'm worth it. You're worth it. Our joy becomes restored when we realize we're worth it, that God's love embraces us regardless of us. This woman was revived in this encounter. This woman was reminded of her worth in this encounter. And finally, this woman was rebranded. An encounter with God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rebrands us. Like this woman, whether you like it or not, you have a brand. This woman came with a brand. She was a shunned woman. She was a divorced woman. She was a Samaritan woman. She was an outcast. She was branded as a woman who lived in sin, a woman who lived with a man she was not married to, a woman who walked in the shadows of society, a woman who carried a water jar. But after she encountered Christ, she became a disciple. She became a woman who carried not only a water jar, but a message. She became a woman who now spoke aloud in the town and proclaimed the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. She became a preacher who led others to seek him out. She now had a new talk. She now had a new walk. She now had a new sense of self. She now realized that she too was a covered woman. She went from hiding and outcast onto center stage. She realized that with Christ, she could walk a little straighter, that with Christ, she could raise up her head, that with Christ, it wasn't perfection, it was striving. With Christ, it was perseverance. With Christ, she could be all that God created her to be. So she no longer let shame and guilt silence. Or anyone been silenced by shame and guilt? The devil has you just where he wants you. If he can convince you that you should be guilty and ashamed, you'll never speak and proclaim the goodness of the Lord. Your faith will stay small because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You won't receive the worth and your value. You won't believe that God came and died and has forgiven your sin. I want to call someone out of the corners of guilt and shame this morning. I want to call you out and remind you who you are. Remind you whose you are. If this sister who had been down in the dumps could raise up her head again and proclaim that Christ lives, that the Messiah we've been waiting on has come and come for you, you too can rise up out of those pockets of guilt and shame with a new brand. Perhaps you've been abused and you feel ashamed. Perhaps you come from a history of molestation. Perhaps you've been fired and lost your job. Perhaps your home was foreclosed upon. Perhaps you've gone bankrupt. Perhaps you've lived lifestyles you had no business living. Perhaps you've lied and cheated. Perhaps you've done some things that you should not have done. But this day, through this story, may you be reminded that in Christ you have a new brand. That after an encounter with God, an encounter with the Holy Spirit, you realize you're no longer a victim, but you're more than a conqueror. That you are no longer lost, but you are redeemed. That you are no longer missing, but you are saved. That you can now do the impossible. That you can hope against hope. That you can defy the darkness of your current reality and rise up with your head lifted high, saying, I am a child of the living God. And because of that, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, who makes me whole. This sister received her blessed assurance. Blessed assurance, I could hear her singing in her head as she walked away. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. There's more to come. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Can't you hear when she now goes to the town? She says, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This man told me everything I've ever done. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. An encounter with Christ, my sisters and my brothers, will revive you, will remind you of your worth, will rebrand you so that you can not only keep on keeping on, but you can do it with a blessed assurance that you're not alone, that your God loves you more than you could ever imagine. And that in him, you have an eternal fount that will never run dry. And your thirst, all that you're craving, can become your testimony. It is in this mighty name of Jesus that we break this bread together, that we share, and that we live. If you are like this woman, you don't have to raise your hand, and I can't even see you. But I want you to know that today is your day. Perhaps you've hung your head low. Perhaps you've continued to think you're not worthy. You try to put on a good face and dress well and get the right makeup just right. But you really haven't received that love. This is your day, because I want to welcome you into a transformational relationship with Jesus Christ. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I invite you to do so right in the privacy of your own space. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart, and he will enter in and become your best friend. For he wants a relationship with you that will transform you. And if perhaps you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you haven't entered into a family of believers who are all pursuing this wonderful God who is pursuing us, I invite you to join and become a part of the Olivet Baptist Church, and the family that is here welcomes you with open arms. Find out more, connect more with a church family that is working out their soul salvation. Do so together. On behalf of Pastor Robinson and his staff, I welcome you to the Olivet Baptist Church. And I don't know if y'all do this at Olivet, but we did this in my church growing up, where we always gave you the opportunity to rededicate your life, to recommit to God and this walk with God in this walk, you will have valleys. But I thank God for moments on the mountain. I thank God for moments at the well where we can reconnect and recommit. So if you haven't received Jesus as your Lord and Savior and want to today, please do so. Reach out to us and we'll reach right back to you. Visit theolivetchurch.org website. Give us your information so that we might connect with you and welcome you into a family that believes and that puts God's words into action. God bless you.
It's offering time, Olivet, as we prepare our tithes and offerings and our seeds for today's Women's Day celebration. Our giver's confession.
Lord, empower me to bless your kingdom. I love you, Lord, and I support the vision and the visionary of this house. I will give cheerfully and not begrudgingly. All that I have belongs to you. I will honor you with the first fruits. I will be a faithful and committed tither. The devourer is rebuked off my life. Lord, we have built you a house, less than bountiful. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture for today is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, the King James Version. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich.
Hello, Olivet family. There is an old Chinese proverb I stumbled upon, which I believe many of us can relate to. What I hear, I forget. What I see, I remember. What I do, I understand. You've heard on many occasions about the goodness of God, but you didn't forget. We've seen God's masterful work in our lives, and we remember to give him all praises. We do the practice of tithing because we understand that every blessing we've had and will ever receive comes from the Lord. Thank you, Olivet family, for continuing to bless his kingdom in your words and in your deeds. God bless you all, Olivet family and friends. Stay safe, stay healthy.
To use PushPay, text Olivet GIVE to 77977 and follow the prompts.
Of diseases, people are slipping away. Economy's down, no place seems to be safe. But you've been my protection every step of the way. And I wanna say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Hey, it could have been me, thank you.
To thank our guest speaker this morning, Reverend Dr. Natasha Reed Rice, for an awesome word. I want to thank the praise team, the musicians, the media ministry, the sound ministry, the office staff, everyone that had a pivotal role in making this Women's Day celebration a success. Thank you, Olivet. I love you.
Now unto the one who is able to encounter us at the well, to change our lives, and to do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever ask or think. To this great God, our Lord and Savior, we give all honor, we give all glory, and we give all praise. May this God be with you now and forevermore. And together we all said, amen.
Thank you.